Imagine we're living in a world where we're not bounded by physical laws. We can talk to anyone we wanted. We can even bring back people from the dead if we wanted to. There are no limits. If you think about the movie The Matrix, the person lives in a completely virtual world. And the society that we're progressing toward goes more and more in that direction. In the future, we're going to create digitized versions of ourselves. But what is the real future we really want to build? How can the technology benefit society? It has to be a future that is healthy and it's good for us. It should also improve us. My name is Hao Li. I'm a computer scientist. I am developing the future of AI-driven virtual humans. And the closest thing to a human-like thing that's virtual is an avatar. So the question is, why do we need virtual avatars? First of all, we're already surrounded by virtual avatars. Video games, for example. Every character in a video game is a virtual avatar. If you think about movies, it started off with Terminator 2 and Jurassic Park. After that, you had movies like Avatar, where they started to incorporate massive motion capture. This technology, it's an expansion of what's possible. One of the visions that we have is really to create digital humans that are indistinguishable from real ones. And in order to create a human that looks very real, you need to get everything right. The second goal is also we're trying to make the creation of digital humans accessible to everyone. And those are sort of the two core challenges that we have to solve. In order to create a digital human, it's a process that takes really, really long. It's not unusual that it would take months to create a high-quality avatar. You know, visual effects is known to be very expensive. This is what we call volumetric capture. The way it works is that you can see here we have a lot of cameras around the volume that you want to capture. So with all these cameras combined, it allows you basically to get a dynamic 3D performance of a person.
All right, Hao, action.
In the future, we're all going to exist in this universe. And we're all going to become 3D avatars and have the ability to teleport anywhere we want. This kind of facility is actually ideal for high-end production, where you can scan an entire person using multiple cameras. But if people ever wanted to create their own avatars, it's unlikely that people would actually have a capture setting like this at home. So we started to think, would it be possible to do volumetric capture without the need of having multiple cameras? We want to build a technology that can generate an avatar from a single photo. And we actually found a way to generate an entire human body from a single photograph. This is how we interact with each other today. We're using video chats, we're using our smartphones, and most of these devices only have a single video camera. So we have Rilong Li here today. He's my PhD student.
On the screen, you can see the front side of the texture, which is actually captured by this web camera. But you can also see the back side of the texture, which cannot actually be seen by this web camera.
If I only see the front of myself, how do I know the back? To get the back of a person, you have to almost imagine what it is, right? But what we wanted to do is see, could we train an artificial intelligence system to do that itself? It's possible to train a deep neural network to process 3D information from a single viewpoint. So this project, we call it volumetric teleportation, because it's not just there to capture a pre-recorded 3D video where it takes hours to process, but it's something that you can stream instantly from one location to another in real time. So I could, in theory, have someone on the other side of this planet wear an AR device and basically see myself in 3D. The pandemic has really influenced the way we interact with each other. The only remote communication we have right now is a video chat, and it's just 2D. You don't really feel the presence of the other person in your room or really close to you. What if people wear headsets and can see each other in 3D remotely? That's one of the technologies that I think are becoming increasingly important, especially in the days that we're physically distanced. But in order to get there, it's very clear that without an avatar, it's not possible.
I'm from China, so my family living in China. We are doing the video conference weekly, but sometimes I feel that's just not enough. I kind of want to see them standing in front of me, and I also know that they want to see me standing in front of them. That's another reason that I would like to contribute myself to this field.
We're trying to recreate a more and more realistic avatar. We're trying to go away from, you know, emojis. We're trying to create something that is more natural to us. But overall, I think we have a first result. I think it's still far from anything that's perfect, but that's where we're at. The human body, the human face, is something very complicated. How light reflects on someone's skin, all the details that are on your face, everything matters. If something is off, it wouldn't look like a real human. The performance of a face, it can really tell a story, right? And the avatars have to look as if they're a real human. Otherwise, there's something really missing. It's actually a very interesting phenomenon called the uncanny valley effect. So what it means is that when people are trying to create a virtual human or something that a human that's synthetic, the more you're trying to make it look real, the harder it is to actually get there. You have the uncanny valley, which is, if it's not entirely perfect, it feels unrealistic. It feels, in some ways, repelling. When you try to create a computer graphics generated human, it becomes harder and harder the more you're trying to get real. Because of that, one of the holy grails in computer graphics was to create the perfect digital human. In the first couple of years, when I was working on this product, it seemed like an impossible problem. One of the challenges and also the beauty of trying to create something that's entirely new is really that there's a lot of unknowns. Not every technology can have a huge success within a few years, right? So certain things take a long time. You just need to have a really long-term vision. As a young child, I was always really fascinated by art. As a kid, you know, one of the first things is like, well, given a paper and just a pencil, can I just create a portrait of someone, right? And in the beginning, it would fail, and you'll feel like, why doesn't it look like the person? And what are the things that are missing? So I was really fascinated by how do painters have the ability to recreate something that almost looks like a photograph. And in some ways, what we're doing is still very similar, right? We're trying to create digital humans, and if there's one thing that's wrong about it, we immediately notice that it doesn't look real. What we're trying to do is we're trying to create something that other people think is impossible, and even to a point where we think is impossible. To make sure that we're creating avatars that look more and more real, there are several things that we're doing in parallel. First thing is it has to look good to us. If it doesn't even match our standard, then there's something wrong. So our standard is basically it has to look at least as good as a AAA game. So what we're gonna see here is our automatic avatar digitization technology that all you need to do is take a picture of yourself, and from that single picture, it can generate an entire avatar. So here you can see that although it's high quality, there's some difference with a real human.
The believability of an avatar really depends on the eyes and mouth. People really focus on those, so it's really important to spend a lot of time around those areas. So that can involve like animation, which is really important and sometimes an underrated aspect.
If it's really bad animation, people are gonna get put off. So in order to make things feel lifelike, they have to feel like they're listening to you. They have to feel like they're understanding what you're saying. I've worked with companies before, and normally it takes a really long time to generate these characters, but it's nice here they get generated so quick. Because of the tech that the geniuses like are making.
We work with digital artists in a very different way than normal visual effects or game studios. The content that they create is actually used as training for our system. So the algorithm, in some ways, is learning how to create an avatar from the artist. But what we're trying to do is really think about how can we create new type of capabilities. What you see here, obviously, is that the avatar is actually moving according to my facial expressions. You have a face tracker that is tracking my face in real time. You can actually animate the characters. You know, I could play a video game right now and have myself in it or my friends in it. We are actually interacting with machines on a daily basis. We talk to our phones. We talk to our Alexa and Siri. We need to obtain information. Now, the use case of an avatar is to basically have the most natural interaction, which is just to talk to another person. And we want to go beyond just creating a virtual assistant that can, you know, respond to some pre-scripted questions. We want to create an avatar that has the ability to have its own mind, that has the ability to have natural conversations with someone. This is our fully autonomous virtual human. You know, it's a really personal project for me. It's actually a digital version of my wife. We digitized her look, her facial expressions, and also created a little AI behind it. So I created this avatar because, first of all, she liked the idea, and people are very sensitive to their own faces. So I think creating an avatar of my wife is the perfect test, right? She could see this doesn't look like me at all, or this is acceptable. Hey, do you like running the company with me?
I do, but not as much as I would like. I like to spend time with my dogs.
Oh, that's a great answer. We work at the intersection of like art and science and math, and blending between them intelligently is a big part of what makes the avatar look extremely realistic.
The path for us is very clear that, you know, in a year or so, I think we're gonna get like 90% accurate to a real human. One of the things that we learned very early on is that you do have to have a responsible approach to developing these type of algorithms, simply because they are extremely powerful.
This is a fully digital version of me.
There's definitely a need for having a good understanding of what the technological capability is and what harm it could potentially have. So a deepfake is a technology that allows you to swap someone's face with yours. You could make that person say and do things that person has never done. So around 2017, I saw in the news some technology called deepfakes. The first use was to use it for non-consensual pornography. And that was the first time I heard about deepfakes. When I saw that, I was like, this is disturbingly similar to what we have been developing for years. And for us, the technology was used to create more realistic avatars and make them accessible to anyone. And suddenly you see that my technology has a potential danger if it's used in the wrong way. And it was an obvious threat to our research community as well. For anyone who's building a sustainable future, we're responsible for being able to build safeguards into the technology. What is important for us is to first educate the public that these kind of technologies are possible. So we modified our technology to showcase how fast deepfakes are advancing. So he can actually move around, you can smile, and you can see how it's possible to generate very convincing faces and manipulate them in real time. With a little bit of production effort, deepfakes are going to become, you know, perfectly indistinguishable from a real footage. We actually got a lot of requests from agencies and organizations, including DARPA, on where it's going, right? So we started to work together on an approach that allows us to not only detect if something has been manipulated, but also can we find who manipulated it? Does it come from a certain source? And also looking at what are next generation threats for data manipulation. It's really hard to predict what can happen, right? But I'm also very optimistic about humans because we've always been able to adapt to new technologies. It feels really amazing, right? You know, sometimes to get away from computers for a while and really to reconnect with, you know, what is actually natural to humans.
Hey, he knows. Don't come. Don't.
Don't. We're kind of like part of building what the future is. So we constantly have to think about like what it potentially could look like, right? But I'm not sure if I want to live in an entirely digital world. I think I would be fine with living in a world where you have both physical and digital. But a completely digital world, I think we as humans are not made for it. We will live in a world where things become a hybrid, right? Really like augmented reality. And augmented reality is in some ways already part of our daily lives. When we create content that we put on social media, we add digital content to it, whether it's 2D or 3D. But how can the technology benefit society and go beyond just, you know, customer service or online shopping, but really reinvent what the next generation of human-machine interaction is? What if we have a way to create a fully autonomous virtual teacher, right? So you could basically create a virtual avatar that is teaching math to kids. And the avatar has the ability to get feedback, create a personalized teaching for every individual. I think that's what our future looks like.
Right, so we can already talk to anyone anytime we want. But in the future, we can actually bring someone in this place here.
And for certain things, you really want the closeness of another person. In the end, it's really about us. It's about interconnection, right? We're reinventing a world that's important to us and we feel comfortable in.